Very cold this morning, so I hope you're all warm and have a cup of coffee. Perhaps you are still in pajamas like I am. Luckily, there's no camera. So yeah, I see we're not that much this morning. I think most of us are still enjoying a late morning, but welcome back. I think yesterday, I'm not sure if we went through this already. So if I can just have an indication from any one of you, did we go through this page yesterday? If we did, just type yes so that I know. I don't want to waste your time. Oh, we did. Okay, Junior said we did. So I'm going to go directly to the exercise. Remember now we studied about, we learned about adjectives and bijvoeglijke naamwoorden. So now I want to start doing activity, and I hope you are ready to work like that little man there. Okay. Oh, Moleni said we only finished the long vowels. Okay. So then I'm quickly just going to run through this. Thank you, Molihe. Sorry, guys, I'm not very good with pronouncing names. But yeah, I'm sure you understand. Okay, so long vowels with the G. Okay, so if you've got a word with a long vowel and it ends on a G. So you see there, O with a G or A with a G. And this is an important thing. I think if I haven't mentioned it yesterday, then I'm mentioning it now again. Most of the time we'll get a DLT taken ear. So please, children, make a little star if you've got this book. Or if you don't have the book and you've got this in front of you, make a little star at long vowel with a G, because sometimes it will change to a DLT taken ear. Look there. But there is exceptions, like the word laag will become la, because I can't say laage. Nee, it's going to sound weird. Moeg will become moe. You see there. So it will, you will still have the same sound. Moeg, you will still have your long vowel, but add it with a DLT taken ear. Vroeger, still the long sound, ending with a DLT taken ear. Okay, now a long vowel ending on a D. If I've got a long vowel, like O or ear or weet, weet that I, Y isn't a long vowel in Afrikaans, and it ends on a D, then the D will change into an E. Exceptions again, breed will have a DLT taken ear, so for me, in my mind, it should actually be there. Oat, you can't say ouweman, you're going to say oat, you're going to say ouman, so there's an exception. Do it, do ye. Goed, goeie. You see the changes there. Another star there. Right. This is an important one. This is easy. If you've got a word ending on lik, smart lik, mooi lik, anything ending on a lik, then it's only going to get an E at the end. Smart lik, you see, ending on a lik, gets an E, smart likke. If I've got adjectives ending on an IG, like prachtig or besig, then it's only going to get an E at the end. Prachtig, prachtige, to fit into that sentence. The man is besig, ending with an IG, die besige man. So remember, we're talking about adjectives now, how to spell adjectives correctly. This is a lekker one for you guys to remember. If you've got any English word, adjective, that ends on an ing. In Afrikaans, it's going to get an e-n-d-e. Die water kook. Kook in English is boiling with an ing. So it's going to be kookende. Sink in English, it's sinking with an ing. So in English, it's, in Afrikaans, it's going to get an e-n-d-e. Right. Then in Afrikaans, colors never change. If I have a sentence and I want to say die rok is rooi, and I want to talk and I want to change the sentence, then it's still going to be die rooi rok. Die wit snoe, die snoe is wit. Die skoene is swart, die swart skoene. And then the following words don't change. Now, I'm not going to read through everything here because both, you know, you and me might just fall asleep. So I'm going to take a, here and there. Die vuilborde, it's dirty dishes. It's going to stay the same. Die drijven is sier, die sier drijven. Sorry, I didn't do that one correctly. Die borde is vuil, die vuil borde. Die drijven is sier, die sier drijven. Die vrouw is vet, die vet vrouw. So the spelling don't change in the other column. But there is always exceptions in Afrikaans. The coffee is bitter. The bitter coffee means coffee is bitter, nee? But if I put emotion, if bitter is used as an emotional word, then it's going to change the spelling. The afskeid was bitter, then it's going to be die bittere afskeid. Die bedelaar is arm. Arm can also, if you just use it as a normal word, where is it? Die straatkinders is arm, it's the street, children on the street is poor. But if I put emotion on it, die bedelaar is arm, then I'm going to say die arme patiënt. Die vruchte is ryp, op een rype ouderdom. Okay, so those are the exceptions. And guys, listen to me carefully. These, you're just going to have to go and study. There's nothing more I can do. You must go and sit and study this. All right, more exceptions. Die man is lank, we're going to say the lang man. Die seentjie is jonk, die jong seun. Die klere is niet, die nieuwe klere. Please go and study that. I just want to make sure, with all the rules here about the F at the end of the words, you must remember the F always turns at the end of the word into a W. But it's when it's a short vowel with an F at the end, it gets two W's and the rest only gets one W. All right. Okay, guys, let's quickly go to the activity. Before we go to the activity, you see there's a reference there. I want you guys to copy that reference or take a photo of it at the end of the session, because this is something that you can go and visit before you study for an exam or a test to learn more about bijvoeglijke naamwoorden. You can go to that website. Okay, children, let's do the activity. They say then, gee die correcte vorm van die bijvoeglijke naamwoord tussen hakies. So I'm going to give you a sentence and the bijvoeglijke naamwoord must change so that the sentence makes sense. So the sentence is currently, Suid-Afrika is a fantastic land for tourism. In English, South Africa is a fantastic country for tourism. But fantastic doesn't fit. So if I've got a word ending on a long vowel and a consonant, what's it going to get at the end? It's going to get an E. So Suid-Afrika is a fantastic land for tourism. Okay, this is how it looks in most of the exam papers and tests as well. And you are going to do this. Ons land biedt een groot interessant verscheidenheid aan elke toerist. It ends on two consonants. What's going to happen there? Can I please ask somebody to type me the answer in there? Angelina, perhaps? Or Mr. iPhone from yesterday? So any one of you? What would the answer there be? Ons land biedt een groot en interessant verscheidenheid voor elke toerist. What would that be? Oh my goodness, are you tired this morning? What do you think? Don't worry, I'm tired as well. Anyone? I'm going to count till five, then I'm going to give you the answer. Ons land biedt een groot en interessant verscheidenheid aan elke toerist. Word ending on two consonants will be interessante. It gets an E. Okay. Om die kabelkar na Tafelberg te ry is een gewild keuse. Ends on two consonants, just as the same here. So how, what is the word going to be? That one got an E. What's going to be here?
Gewilde.
Gewilde. Thank you, iPhone. Am I correctly? Yeah, I'm correct. I remember that voice. Gewilde. Good. In die Magaliesberge is daar 'n kleurvol ligballonne. It ends on a short vowel followed by a consonant. What's going to happen there? Something's gonna double. In die
Magaliesberge.
Name
from a V to a double W.
No, my lovey. There's no V in this one. It's an OL at the end. You see there? So it's a short vowel ending on and with an L at the end, which means it's going to double. Clear volle. The L is going to double, and I'm going to put an E at the back. But thank you, my darling. In Durban is daar die helder water om in te ski, scuba en branders te ry. Now this one you have to think of. In English it would be in Durban there is the most clear water to ski and scuba and surf in. Daai helder. In Durban is daar die helder. Look there. It ends in a short vowel on another helder. It's going to be a long vowel sound. And then consonant at the back. What do you think it's going to be? In Durban is daar die helder water om in te ski, te scuba en branders te ry. Take a chance, you know. See if you can type the answer in there for me or say the answer. What do you think it should be? Okay, Junior said helder. It must be helderste. Thank you, Junior. So remember it's getting a st at the back. And here you can think of the rule with degrees of comparison. Right, the next one. Die groot mensgemaakte gat in die wereld is Kimberley. That big hole in Kimberley. It's about that. Die groot mensgemaakte gat. Okay, guys. Jess said groote. Remember, it's a long vowel. That's it. Guapele said grootste. Thank you, guys, for participating. Good. Die grootste mensgemaakte gat in die wereld is Kimberley. This one is it's a long sentence. Toeriste. Wat lemoene in die Gamtoosvallei in die Ooskaap koop, is beslis slim as die vat in dit in die winkels koop. Slimmer, good Jess, thank you so much. Right, the next one. This sentence has three of them in, so see if you can type all three at once. Die lang ry van motors by die Walter Sisulu Nasionale Botaniese Tuine in Gauteng is a good aanduiding that it a gewild keuse is. It ends on a two consonants. What's going to happen then? Jace, you said langste. It's actually the lang rye. Die lang rye van motors by die Walter Sisulu Nasionale Botaniese Tuine in Gauteng. And then is a good. What do you think that's going to be? Don't worry about spelling, guys. Okay, goed. Okay, it's going to be beste, that it a gewild, two consonants at the end, so it's just going to get an E. Oskies, daar must be a goeie, sorry. Lang goeie gewilde, that is the answers. Die lang rye van motors by die Walter Sisulu Nationale Botaniese Tuin in Gauteng is a goeie aanduiding dat het a gewilde plek is. Next one. In Limpopo sal jy vroeg as gewoonlik moet opstaan wanneer jy in die Kreerwildtuin is. Met sonsopkoms jag die leeu's maklik omdat hulle honger is. Okay, I want you to concentrate now. Look how vroeg. Remember what I said about words ending on a G with a long vowel. Gonna happen. It's gonna get a deel teken something. As gewoonlik moet opstaan wanneer jy in die Kreerwildtuin is. Met sonsopkoms, jag die leeu's maklik. Ending on a short vowel in a K. Okay, so in Limpopo sal jy vroeër with the word be. Thank you, Jason Jr. As gewoonlik moet opstaan wanneer jy in die Kreerwildtuin is. Met sonsopkoms, jag die leeu's makliker. Right. There's only two more left. Two more left. Dilstroom is bekend vir sy moegvissermanne. Dis die goed plek om vlieghengel te doen. That one's going to change into a total different word. Dilstroom is bekend vir sy moegvissermanne. Look what I did here at vroeger. What's going to happen to moeg? Look at that ear there. Moeg. Jess, modern you said. Jess, quickly look here. Vroeger, it's got a deel teken ear. What's going to happen with moeg? It's going to be the same rules going to apply there. Dis die goed plek om te... Okay, so you said that goeie Angelina is going to be beste. So the answer is moe and beste. Look at the spelling of moe. You still have your oe sound and it got some deelteken e at the back. Dalstrom is bekend vir sy moe vissermanne. Dis die beste plek om vlieghengel te doen, fly fishing. Ok, nummer 11, laaste een. Om net vir 'n half dag, look there, the F, extreme makeover, what's going to happen? Dag, deur die klein Karoo te ry, sal jy weer die stilte en die mooi van die wyd land laat waardeer. Junior sê halwe, correct. Om net vir 'n halwe dag deur die klein Karoo te ry, sal jy weer die stilte en die mooi van die wyd vlaktes laat waardeer. What's going to happen with that D? It's a long vowel ending with a D. So something's going to fall away and it's going to get an E. What do you think is that going to be? Try. Om net vir 'n halwe dag deur die klein Karoo te ry, sal jy weer die stilte en die mooi van die wyd vlaktes laat waardeer. Long vowel and the D at the end, something's going to fall away and it's going to become an E. Jess said weier, it is weier. The D fell away and it became an E. It also went for a makeover, nee? Okay, listen to me quickly. If you want this slide, or this PowerPoint, there is my email address, melissapinar.atg@gmail.com. Take a picture or write the email address down. Then you type an email for me saying who you are. I'm ma'am, my name is Junior and I'm in grade 7 and I would like the PowerPoint on WordSort of on by whatever. Okay, so I'm gonna know what PowerPoint to send you, so don't worry. Okay, Melissa Pinar, 2 S's. .atg@gmail.com. So if you want this, send me an email with your name and your grade, and I will send you the email. I'm going to give you about 10 seconds to write down that email address before I go on to the next part. On now. Remember, an email, email your name and your grade, and I'll send it to you. Please check the spelling of my name. It's got 2 S's and 1 L. 1 L, 2 S's, and pinar.atg@gmail.com. All right, can I go on to the next PowerPoint? Just type yes if I can, please. Okay, Juan Pelli said no. Okay, just a moment. Guys, just write the email address now and after class you quickly pop me the email. All right. Junior or Jess, Tafisu, Molie, okay, can I go on now? Please just say yes. Right, thank you. I'm going on. Hey guys, thank you. You guys are so sweet. I just see yeses. Okay, so let's quickly then go to the next PowerPoint. Also, a lesson where you have to concentrate. So I want you now to take a deep breath, get your notepads out and a pen, and I want you to focus. So now, today we're starting with revision Woordsoorte deel 2. So it's part 2 of the revision classes that I'm going to have for the next week. And it's Woordsoorte, and now you must focus, please. Today, we are going to focus on werkwoorde and bijwoorde. In English, verbs and adverbs. Right, now most of you might start shivering now or something because you might be scared of werkwoorde and so on, but I have really gone in this PowerPoint and I've put everything in categories for you so that you would understand. And I made a promise to the other grades that I will make you a nice summary. And I will definitely do that. A nice summary of werkwoorden so that you can go and study from it also. I've also taken the liberty to get you a lot of resources. So if you go and study for the exam or test, there is a lot of resources that you can also go and study from on the internet. And of course, at the end of this PowerPoint, I'm also more than willing to send you this PowerPoint to study off from. Okay, so ons focus dan op werkwoorden en bijwoorden. Now in Afrikaans, it's called werkwoorden, but it's also known as gezegdes. So you might have seen the word gezegdes before. It is what the other name for, it's the other name for werkwoorden in Afrikaans. Right guys, then of course, in English, it's called verbs, but that you should know. What do we know about verbs? First of all, we know that a werkwoord duidt een actie of een handeling aan. In other words, it's an action word. In Afrikaans, also known as doenwoorden. Doenwoorden, action words, actiewoord. It's something that we do, nee. And now you must concentrate. Take your pen and a piece of paper and write the following down. We get four types of werkwoorden. The first being zelfstandige werkwoorden. There is the first one, zelfstandige werkwoorden. And underneath zelfstandige werkwoorden, you get oorganklik, onoorganklik, onpersoonlik en wederkerend. So this is the first main type of werkwoord, is called the zelfstandige naamwoord. Next is the second big one, which is hulpwerkwoorden. And underneath hulpwerkwoorden, we get tyd, wyse, vorm. Then, third main one is koppelwerkwoorden. And then, the infinitief. Okay, so listen to me. Write down all four main types. And remember, the first two has got four or three underneath them as well. So I'm going to give you a few seconds, write this down. Okay, if you've done this, then I'm quickly going to go on to the next slide, but I'm going to give you another 20 seconds or so because I know you have to write it down properly. Okay, so that is it then. Then I am going to, okay, thank you. I see Jason Junior said they are done. So I'm presuming that most of you are then done. Okay, so the first main one is then zelfstandige werkwoorden. And please look at the picture here. This little guy, he is running. He is running and he's kicking. Nee, which means zelfstandige werkwoorden refers to the main verb in a sentence. And that is known as the following. This is a verb that can stand on its own in a sentence. Hy kan alleen staan in 'n sin. En daar is vier types selfstandige werkwoorde, namelijk die oorganklike, die onoorganklike, onpersoonlike en die wederkerend. So those are the four types of selfstandige werkwoorde, main verbs that you get. The first one is then oorganklik. And now I'm going to explain that one to you. More than welcome to make notes as we go along. I'll talk slowly. I hope you don't sleep, but it's very important that you rather understand this work than anything else. Right. 'N oorganklike selfstandige werkwoord. 'N oorganklike main verb word gevolg deur 'n voorwerp. In other words, in a sentence, there will be the verb, die oorganklike verb, and after it, there will be an object. So look here. And then there's a test. If you want to know whether what the object is, you can ask yourself wie en wat word aangedui. So you look at the verb and you ask yourself who and what, and then you know what the object is. For instance, die man eet 'n appel. That is a normal sentence. Die man eet 'n appel. Eet is my oorganklike werkwoord because after it, there is a object. Eet is my oorganklike werkwoord because after it, the word appel appears, which is then the object. Right, how do I test it? Wie, wat word, wie eet? Die man. Wat eet die man? Wat eet die man? Hy eet 'n appel. Right, so copy this quickly or take a picture. 'N oorganklike werkwoord is then a verb followed by the object in the sentence. First the verb, then the object, and then you know this is 'n oorganklike werkwoord. Okay, the next one is selfstandige werkwoorde, onoorganklik. So the first one was oorganklik. Now we get onoorganklik, and it will be the following. There is no object after the verb, then you know it's onoorganklik. So I'll get a verb, and if there's no object after the verb, then it's not, then it's an onoorganklike werkwoord. For example, hulle ry ver. Ry is my onoorganklike werkwoord. Ver, that is not something I can hold. Nee, so it's not an object, which indicates that ry is an onoorganklike werkwoord because ver tells me how far they are driving. They are driving very far. Okay. Then onpersoonlik. Onpersoonlik is, I think the English term might be impersonal or something like that. I almost want to tell you, go and look. I don't know how many of you have actually watched Frozen. Now, Frozen, the movie, there's lots of ice and it's cold, nee. So onpersoonlike selfstandige werkwoorde give us the feeling that there is coldness, nee. There's no emotion in this word. In other words, onpersoonlik refers to, it doesn't refer to anything specific. So not a specific animal or person or thing. Bijvoorbeeld dit. Dit is the onpersoonlike werkwoord. Reën. Reën al lank hier in die Karoo. There's no emotion with reën. Nee. Reën dui nie op iets spesifieks nie. So it's not something specifically in the sentence. Dit reën al lank hier in die Karoo. Reën is just a normal, impersonal verb. There's no emotion connected to it. So onpersoonlik, it's not something specific. Not an animal or a person or a thing. Then wederkerend. Now look at this picture. It looks like a lot of fun, nee? So I want you to think about dancing here. If I ask you, what is a selfstandige werkwoord wederkerend, then you must think about dancing. This is a very easy one. This is when the onderwerp, which is the subject, and the voorwerp, the object, is the very same thing. Bijvoorbeeld, hy vererg hom, he's annoyed with. That hy and the hom refers to the same person. Look there, my mouse is dancing. Die hy en die hom is the very same person. Then it's called wederkerend. Look at the two E's in wederkerend. The first two E's, you see there, die hy en die hom is the same thing. So those two E's indicate that it's the same person there. Okay, again, those two E's and even those two E's indicate that it's the very same person. That is what the wederkerende werkwoord is. When the onderwerp and the voorwerp is dieselfde ding. Hy vererg hom. But, because I told you yesterday, in Afrikaans there is always exceptions. Sometimes the verb will always be wederkerend. Sometimes die werkwoord gaan altyd wederkerend wees. For instance, sy was die motor. Sy is the only, was is the only werkwoord in the sentence. But there's only one indicator there. Sy was die motor. Nie as self nie, daar is 'n direkte voorbeeld. Dis oorganklik. So sometimes, there will be a voorwerp in the sentence, but there's also the object which might refer to the same. All right. So soms is die werkwoord altyd wederkerig. Sy was die motor, sy was nie haarself nie, daar is 'n direkte voorwerp. Die direkte voorwerp is die motor en daarom is was die oorganklike werkwoord. Okay. Think of dancing, né? Hy en hom is dieselfde. Guys, there's a reference there, Dr. Christa van Staden's voorbeeld. So if you also want to go and learn a bit more about some of these werkwoorde, go to that website of Dr. Christa van Staden and you will have some more examples there. Okay. Before I go on to the next one, because now we've only done the first main one, which is selfstandige werkwoorde. Do you all understand up until now? Before I go on, I first want to see that. Because I care and I don't want you to just study this stuff. I want you to properly understand it. Yes, Sifiso said, yes, ma'am, I do understand. Right, Sifiso? Anyone else? Jess said a little bit, okay. Jess, can you please indicate to me what it is you don't understand? And just give me a name, then I'll go back for you and I'll explain it to you. Min says, yes, ma'am, I understand. Right. Remember, I don't mind going back and explaining them to you again. Not so much. Junior said, no, not so much. Okay. I have two kids that says, no, ma'am, I don't understand properly, and therefore I am going back. Okay, so remember now, I told you there is four types of werkwoorde. The first one is a selfstandige werkwoord. The second one is a hulpwerkwoord. Then koppelwerkwoorde. Then the infinitief. Now, we've only done the first one so far. The first one. We've done selfstandige werkwoorde, which can be divided into four. Oorganklik, onoorganklik, onpersoonlik, wederkerend. I quickly want to tell you something about myself here. I don't like giving examples just quickly in a lesson, because for the simple reason, sometimes if I think of an example just like that, it might be firstly a stupid example, or secondly the wrong example, because I don't like doing that. I like to go and research stuff. So what I'm going to do is, after this entire lesson, I promised my other students I'll make you guys a summary of the werkwoorde, and I'll also go and look for some extra examples. So I will definitely, if I've done the slides, I will give you a few extra examples. You'll also see I've got lots of references in this slideshow. So please don't worry about it. You will have enough to study from. Okay, so selfstandige werkwoorde is then the very first one. And that is words that can stand alone in a sentence. For instance, running or kicking or laughing. And then we've got four types of the selfstandige werkwoorde, which is oorganklik, onoorganklik, onpersoonlik, and wederkerend. I'm going to go slowly now. First one is oorganklike selfstandige werkwoord. Remember now, oorganklik means there is an object after the verb. All right, so look here. I can test it by asking myself who and what this verb is about. And the example, die man eet 'n appel. Who is eating an apple? The man. What is he eating? He's eating an apple. If you look at that sentence, die man eet 'n appel, the verb in that sentence is eet. And we know an oorganklike werkwoord has got an object after it. So there is eet, after it is the word appel, which means eet is an oorganklike werkwoord because there is an object after that verb. Okay. Right. I'm going to ask every little time, oorganklik. Do you all understand oorganklik? I want to see yeses. That, okay, Min says yes. If I see yeses, then I'll go on to the next one. Okay, Gwampele, you don't understand. Okay, that's why I said to you guys, I'm not going to give you examples from my head here, because it might be wrong. So again, If I've got a verb and after it, the object in the sentence. Now, I think, guys, you must probably ask yourself, what is an object? An object is something that I can touch. So if it, and I can see, it's almost like a selfstandige werkwoord. It is probably. So if I say, die man sit op 'n tafel, then tafel would be the voorwerp, and it is after the verb, which is sit. So if I say, die man sit op die tafel, sit is my werkwoord, and I sit op die tafel, tafel is na die werkwoord, then that sit is a oorganklike werkwoord. So first the verb, then the object, if then we know that verb is a object, is a oorganklike werkwoord. I'm going to repeat myself again with this example. Die man eet 'n appel. Eet is my verb. He's eating an apple. Eat is my verb. It's an oorganklike verb because apple is the object and it's after the verb. Kumapele, what do you say now? Okay, my boy. I will definitely give some examples there. All right, guys, let's go on to selfstandige werkwoorde onoorganklik. Okay, so this is the second type of selfstandige werkwoorde, which is called onoorganklik. So remember the first one was oorganklik. That's when the verb is when the object is behind the verb. Now, onoorganklik means the verb, there is no object after the verb. First one, oorganklik, object after verb. Now, onoorganklik, no object. Oh, sorry, Gumapelli. I didn't know. I just assumed. Sorry. Okay. All right. I'm getting to know you guys. Sorry, Gumapelli. Word nie deur 'n voorwerp gevolg nie. Byvoorbeeld, hulle ry ver. Now, look at this example again. Ry is my verb. They are riding far or driving far. Ry is my verb. Driving is the verb. Ver is telling me how they are driving. Far is telling me how they are driving. There is no object in this in that sentence, which means it is an onoorganklike verb. Ry is an onoorganklike verb because there is no object in the sentence. Do you understand thus far? Can I go on to the next one? Ma'am, what's the difference between all the selfstandige werkwoorde? The difference is that I'm explaining here now. Remember, there's four types, and that's the differences. So there's not one specific difference that explains all of them as such. So there's different differences, if I can put it like that, and that is what I'm explaining. So remember, selfstandige werkwoorde, and then underneath that iPhone, there is four of that. And then those four gets explained individually. Do you understand now? iPhone, can you just give me your name again, please? I think it was Kai. Maybe I'm wrong. Okay. You still don't understand, iPhone, or what is your name? Bule, okay. Bule, do you understand, or do you want me to, maybe we should just talk about this after I've done all four of them, rather. But remember what I said, there's not one specific difference that I can tell about all of them. That's why we have to understand. Okay, so you say now you do understand. Okay, Jess said, so ry is the verb. Yes, my darling. And the reason I highlighted fair here is because it's telling me about the verb. Okay, so ry is the actual verb. Driving is the verb. Okay, the next one. Selfstandige werkwoord, onpersoonlik. This is why I talked about Frozen, the movie. The only thing you must know here is that an onpersoonlijke verb does not tell me something about a person or an animal or a thing. Not at all. So it's just a normal verb. It's reën al lank hier in die Karoo. There is no emotion that's linked to a verb, this verb, onpersoonlijke verb. So onpersoonlijke werkwoord, no emotions. It doesn't tell me anything about an animal, a person or a thing. And then the example here, dit reen al lang hier in die Karoo. It's raining now for a long time in the Karoo. Raining is my verb. And it doesn't tell me anything about emotions. So then it's onpersoonlijk. You understand this one. Angelina, you are very quiet today, my love. Angelina says yes. Anyone else? Jess said, no, I don't understand. Okay. Okay, guys, again, I'm going to go through this again. So onpersoonlijk, when I say I take something personally, it means there's a emotion connected to it. Né? So if I say I'm taking something persoonlijk, then there's an emotion. But if I say somebody is onpersoonlijk or something is onpersoonlijk, then there's a certain coldness to it. In other words, something is totally, 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 there's no emotion linked to it at all. So if I say there's no emotion, then I'm not saying something about an animal or a person or a thing with any warmth in me. So there's nothing. That's how I'm always remembering this. So the word rien of rei, for instance, can also be impersonal. Is words that has no emotion in it. So there's no link between animals or persons or things. For that reason, the following sentence, het rien al lang hier in die Karoo. Only verb in that sentence is rien. Does rien give me an emotion? Let me ask. Is rien an emotional word for you? In this sentence, does it have any emotion? Het rien al lang hier in die Karoo. No, it's the only verb in the sentence. Nee. And that rien will then tell me about no emotion. So rien does not say about something specific. So it doesn't tell me about anything specific. And yes, gomapeli, rien is the verb in this sentence. Okay. Does it make a little bit more sense to you guys now? Remember, onpersoonlijk, iPhone, boele, yes, how it is rien. Rien is the verb in that sentence. And rien is rain. It's raining. Jess said, okay. All right. Guys, I'm going on to the next slide. I'm so afraid we're not going to get finished. Oh, you see, it's 42 minutes already. You see now. You see now. Okay. Guys, let me run through the next one first. So, wederkerend is then dancing, which means the onderwerp, which is the subject, and the voorwerp, the object, is the very same thing in the sentence. He is annoyed with, okay, so that's a terrible example in English. You see now, that's why I don't like giving examples. Hy vererg hom. What is the word for vererg in English? It means somebody sort of annoyed. Other word is vies, half angry, nee. So if you are angry at somebody, die hy in hom refers to the same person. So if you've got two verbs in the sentence, well, vererg, vererg is the verb, look there. Vererg is the verb, but it's getting linked with two other words. And then we know it's a wederkerende woord. Vererg is the verb and hy in hom refers to the same person. So wederkerende verb is when the verb is linked with this very same person. Right. And sometimes the werkwoord is altijd wederkerig. Sy was die motor. Was is my werkwoord in die sin. She's washing the car. Wash is the werkwoord in that sentence. And sy is the only one they're referring to in the sentence, and therefore it is a wederkerende werkwoord. Okay. Before I go off. Remember, I promised I'll give you a few extra examples, and I will do that when I give you the summary of this. All right. So, put on your masks, sanitize your hands, have a good weekend, and enjoy your classes, and drink lots and lots and lots of Milo. Okay. See you on Monday. Bye-bye, guys.
Yes, ma'am. Bye.